Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. So in this video I'm gonna show you guys how to answer questions that involve anemias and how to differentiate their types, and that's on step 2 CK can also benefit for step 1. So let's get started. Alright guys, so whenever I have a question with labs like this, I like to read the labs first as they help me reach the diagnosis before even reading the vignette. So here, hemoglobin, this value is low for anyone, male or female. As a rule, any hemoglobin value below 11 is considered anemic. Platelet count here is low, that's below 150,000. Total bilirubin is high and LDH is high. Whenever you see guys anemia, low hemoglobin with high bilirubin and high LDH, right away you know hemolysis is taking place, that this type of anemia is hemolytic, because red blood cells are being broken down and releasing out LDH and bilirubin, or heme that will turn into bilirubin. And so now I know there is a hemolytic process taking place. Now, an additional clue here will be haptoglobin. Haptoglobin level here is low, indicates that the type of hemolytic anemia taking place here, guys, is intravascular. It's taking place inside the circulation. Now, this is because haptoglobin is a protein, haptin, that protects your body from the free radical effect of iron, so that whenever any free hemoglobin coming out in the circulation will bind to it right away and be phagocytosed promptly to prevent iron from causing oxidative stress. And so when I see that the haptoglobin level is low, it means that it has been consumed by all this intravascular hemolytic process taking place. So without even finishing the question, I can exclude some of the answer choices here, guys. Acute intermittent porphyria is excluded because this is not a type of intravascular hemolytic anemia, as well as aplastic anemia, and we can keep the rest. So let's continue reading the last two lines before going to the vignette. Further workup, including MRI of the abdomen, shows hepatic vein thrombosis. This, guys, is almost a giveaway to the diagnosis. Without even reading the vignette, just reading this and diagnosing this as hemolytic anemia is almost always a clue that this is paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. It's very characteristic that this type of hemolytic anemia, guys, causes thrombosis. Here we have a 43-year-old woman coming to the ER with abdominal pain and dark urine. Physical exam shows right upper quadrant tenderness, which indicates something is wrong with her liver and that this is an acute process, because hepatic vein thrombosis or Budd-Chiari syndrome leads to backup of blood in the liver and the entire port of circulation, causing pain. Now, because hemolysis releases a lot of cytokines and tissue factor, this is what initiates the procoagulant process. Now, you all know, guys, the pathogenesis of this disease is that there is deficiency of a complement inhibitor, so that complement is always activated to break down not just red blood cells but all blood cells, and that is responsible for intravascular hemolysis. Now, why not G6PD deficiency? Because this, guys, is an X-linked condition that is almost always seen in boys, exclusively in boys. Now, why not hereditary spherocytosis? Simply because hereditary spherocytosis is chronic. Here, she's presenting in the acute setting. Plus, spherocytosis is mostly due to extravascular hemolysis, and therefore haptoglobin levels will not be low. And also, if the examiner wants you to choose spherocytosis, there will be a hint to family history of anemia or cholecystectomy, right? Or family history of splenectomy. And there's going to be an enlarged spleen that is always breaking down all those abnormal red cells. So the only correct answer here, guys, is PNH or paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. And this woman is having right upper quadrant tenderness and hepatomegaly due to hepatic vein. Alright, so let's read the labs first as we're used to. Hemoglobin level is low, so this is anemia. We don't know yet. Reticulocytes are 7%. This guy's considered very high because reticulocytes should not exceed 1 to 1.5% of peripheral blood. These are considered RBC precursors. The fact that we have a lot of red blood cell precursors means that red blood cells are being broken down in the peripheral circulation. And this is why the factory, which is the bone marrow, is trying to increase its production as much as it can to compensate for peripheral loss. This peripheral loss is either bleeding or hemolysis. So let's see. Urine analysis shows blood, moderate blood, so there is hematuria. However, red blood cells under the microscope in urine are zero per high power field. What that means, guys, is that the urine dipstick detected heme, which is what is, interpreted as blood, when in reality there is no red blood cell. So this heme is not coming from red blood cells or is not a result of red blood cells in urine. Rather, this heme is coming, guys, from either hemoglobin or myoglobin. Right, so there is either, in this case, there is hemoglobinuria or myoglobinuria. But what do you expect, guys, in this setting that we have low hemoglobin, high reticulocytes? It's apparent that this is probably hemolytic anemia and that this heme detected by the dipstick as blood is in fact hemoglobin. So this person is having hemoglobinuria due to intravascular hemolysis. So here I figured out, guys, there is intravascular hemolysis from another lab parameter. He might give me haptoglobin and that will be nice and it will be a giveaway, but we can also figure out from hemoglobinuria that this case of hemolytic anemia is also intravascular. Now let's read the answer choices. Autoantibody production means autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Yes, this could be intravascular, but it's mostly extravascular. We are going to keep that for a little bit. B, complement activation. Yes, this is possible with paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. We cannot exclude this answer choice. Immune complex deposition, however, guys, is incorrect. Here he's talking about probably glomerulonephritis or something. This is not the case here because we've seen that the blood in urine here is not due to red blood cells. So this person is not really having hematuria. Interstitial leukocyte infiltration. No, it does not explain the urinary findings. This is not glomerulonephritis, guys. This is not acute interstitial nephritis. There is nothing wrong with the kidneys. And oxidative injury. So here we're between three answer choices. Let's read the vignette. A 23-year-old man, and I want you guys to figure out to keep an eye on the demographic. Is it a man or a woman? Because a lot of hemolytic anemias are X-linked, right? Coming to the ER due to sudden onset of fatigue and dark urine. We've already known why, because of hemoglobinuria. The patient was recently diagnosed with dermatitis herpetiformis, which associates celiac disease. He began treatment with Dapsone and a gluten-free diet 3 days ago. Note here, guys, we have a drug. New introduction of a drug in hematology questions. He's either guiding you towards autoimmune hemolytic anemia or G6PD deficiencies. Either one of these due to recent drug use. This morning, the patient felt weak, difficulty getting out of bed. You can see here, it's 3 days after introduction of a drug, not weeks, it's 3 days, right? His urine is dark, Vitals are normal. Patient appears tired, of course. His red blood cells are being broken down. Examination shows scleral icterus, which is jaundice due to bilirubin accumulation as it's released from red blood cells. There is a papular rash along the scalp, elbows, and knees. He's talking here, guys, about dermatitis herpetiformis. And here are the labs. So as you can see, guys, we have a guy or man, male, who has recently started taking a drug and suddenly is suffering intravascular hemolysis. Obviously, it's very apparent that this is G6PD deficiency. However, it could also be autoimmune hemolysis. But autoimmune hemolysis, guys, is extravascular, which means it will not cause dark urine. This is number one. Number two, for autoantibodies to be produced, we need at least 1 to 2 weeks, not 3 days ago, right? So the cause here, guys, is most probably G6PD deficiency, because dapsone is one of the no-nos for G6PD deficient patients, and it induces oxidative injury. So this is the correct answer. All right, let's move on to the next question. Let's read the labs again. Lab results are as follows. Hemoglobin is 8.5. This is below normal for any demographic. MCV is high. This is macrocytic anemia. Platelet count is borderline. It's normal. Blood glucose, I would consider this high if it were fasting blood glucose, and the rest are insignificant. What we're concerned here, guys, would be macrocytic anemia, which has several reasons. Could be megaloblastic anemia or non-megaloblastic anemia, meaning that the red blood cells are big or are macrocytes, either because there is something wrong with the bone marrow. This is megaloblastic anemia, which would affect other cell lines, not just red blood cells. Or non-megaloblastic means that the red blood cells only are affected and they're being macrocytic and the other cell lines are not affected. So what is the most likely cause here? I can exclude some answer choices just because they don't cause macrocytic anemia. For example, chronic blood loss. This one, guys, causes iron deficiency anemia, which is microcytic hypochromic. So it's unlikely given these lab values. Anemia of chronic disease is not macrocytic. It's either normocytic or microcytic, all right? Now, thiamine deficiency does not really commonly lead to anemia, but if it does, it will not be macrocytic as well. So here we're between B12 and folate. Let's read the vignette and see. A 55-year-old man comes to the office due to fatigue for the past month, obviously signs of anemia. He has had occasional heartburn, but no chronic abdominal pain. Here, guys, this is excluding pernicious anemia. But again, we haven't completely excluded it. Medical history is significant for hepatomegaly due to fatty liver. Now we need to know, why does he have fatty liver? He has been drinking 3 to 4 shots of alcohol per day for several years. So this guy is a chronic alcoholic. He does not smoke. Physical exam reveals pallor of skin and mucous membranes. These are signs of anemia and mild hepatomegaly. Now, which is more likely, guys, for a chronic alcoholic? Is it folate or B12 deficiency? In fact, both can happen. But what is more likely to be promptly deficient would be folate, because it's not stored in the liver as much as B12 is. We need at least 6 years for B12 to be used up, and for someone who doesn't eat any animal protein ever or any animal product. But folic acid can very easily be deficient within weeks. All right, and this is very likely in a chronic alcoholic who is consuming empty calories, which means it's unlikely that this person is eating green leafy vegetables, for example, because he's so busy having alcohol, and even when he does have food, he will not opt for healthy or folic acid rich sources. So it's very easily deficient in chronic alcoholics. And the thing about folic acid here, guys, is that it's the one that mediates pyrimidine synthesis, the nucleotides that make up the DNA of red blood cell precursors in order to make a red blood cell, right? And so this type of anemia, guys, I would say would be megaloblastic, meaning it does not just affect red blood cells, it also affects white blood cells. And that's why we see hypersegmented neutrophils and all these stuff. We see a hypocellular marrow. And the cause of a big red blood cell is that it did not get the chance to divide or undergo mitosis because there weren't enough DNA to replicate, right?